from a policy perspective, but also from a research perspective, in that it's one way of, for us to start seeing again why in many areas you're not going to make a lot of progress on coming up with policy prescriptions through research unless you think quite hard about the underlying models of what's driving behavior. So let me start with some motivation on what we see as patterns in women's work. I want to then argue that one of the big differences that we see in the data is that while men, especially young men, seem to largely be making decisions themselves about going out to work and where to work, a woman's decision to work is never her own. There seem to be many people involved in the decision, and it's largely a family decision whether she works rather than her own decision. And this, I want to argue, suggests that we can't make a lot of progress in trying to understand or think about how to raise female labor supply without thinking harder about models of household choice and what underlies them. And I want to argue that in some ways an absence to think about it has led to somewhat misleading conclusions in some of the recent experimental literature. And I'm going to use some examples from microfinance to talk about that. And then finally, depending on time, I'd like to spend a bit of time talking about some of the recent work I and colleagues have been doing on actually asking whether you can use instruments like financial inclusion in ways that will actually affect female labor supply. So let me start with, in some sense, a fact that many of you have probably seen. It's been documented by many that this data goes from 2005, but you could start pretty much around the time of structural transformation in 1990s, and what you're going to see is female labor force participation has declined quite significantly. And this has happened in the background of rising female enrollment, and as I'll talk about later, in some sense, I think in a lot of the literature, the presumption had tended to be that if you increase education, you're going to see good things happen to women. Education has increased a lot, but certainly when it comes to female labor supply, at aggregate, we don't see it pushing up female labor supply. I think it's also relevant to put the picture of India in context of the South Asian neighbors. So if you look across South Asian countries, male labor force supply is quite stable. So pretty much if you look at the adult population of 15 to 65, it's around 80% of the male labor force participation in every country. But once you start looking at female labor supply, you see pretty significant differences. And India is just above Pakistan, but focusing on the mean misses the fact that in Pakistan, actually, female labor supply has been going up, while in India, it's been going down. So if you just extrapolate on the existing trends, I think in a couple of years, Pakistan will be higher than India, and India will actually be the bottom. Even if I did the same ranking by income, India would come at the top. Now, a first response that economists tend to have to this, which derives from Claudia Golden's seminal work, that maybe most of this is just picking up an income effect, that women potentially want to just enjoy leisure, and income allows them to do that. You don't have to do crappy back-breaking work. So you can try to look at, in some sense, what people typically look at just correlationally, which is there a U-shaped curve in labor supply with respect to income such that when income rises above a certain point, we see women drop out. So this is just a plot from data from 2013 for the world, excluding the Middle East, because that looks quite different. So what you see is you can fit a U-shape. I think it's not a very strong U-shape. You can fit it. But what you see is that India and Pakistan are just extreme outliers. This is not a case, maybe Indian women really like leisure, but they are extreme outliers. You can see that China is actually on the other side. And if I have time, I'll talk a little bit about the difference between China and India. China has relatively high labor force participation compared to where it is in the income distribution. But India and Pakistan are very low. So I wrote a piece on this for the popular press a few years ago. And the comments section was full of comments of the kind that you're imposing Western ideals on Indian women, that in India, the family is very important, and you can't use data like this to argue that there is any constraints. This is actually just reflecting the fact that Indian culture is very different. So one thing you can do is, in the National Sample Survey, among women who don't work, who report themselves as housewives, you can ask the question of, if there was work available near your house, would you like to take it up? And that, in some sense, is a direct measure of latent demand. So when you look at that, there's very significant willingness to accept work by housewives. And the two things that are worth pointing out in this, it dominates in the rural relative to the urban areas. And in the rural areas, it's actually increasing with education. So what we see is, if you just gave work to all the women who state that they would like to work, you would actually increase India's female labor force participation by something like 70%. Farzana and her colleagues have done some great work sort of showing that in recent times, even though in general rural labor force participation is higher than urban labor force participation, the declines that we see recently are to a large extent driven by the rural sector. So I want you to keep that in mind as we go ahead, that there, it seems to be both the case that there is low participation, much lower than would be predicted by income levels, and alongside, there seems to be substantial unmet demand among women, especially in the rural sector. And importantly, this is, it's not necessarily increasing, but certainly not decreasing with education. So it doesn't appear to be the case that education is pushing it down. And I think that's important because one thing a number of people have argued is that that there is a marriage market premium to education and that women are getting educated because the premium in the marriage market. If that was the case, you would expect potentially that demand to be lower among educated women, which we don't see here. So the flip side of it is, where do women go when they move out of education, when they move out of agriculture? So I think there's certainly no doubting the fact that some of the push out of Indian women is coming because they're not so willing to work anymore in agricultural work. And I think that's probably underlying a lot of what we see in the rural sector. A lot of them, as we've seen, end up being with domestic duties and not working. But those who do work, where do they go? And here I think there's a key difference between what's happening in India versus, say, a country like China. So in China, what we see is a large rise in wage employment. In India, what you see is that the most common sector outside of agriculture is what's known as own account or self-employment. And in fact, reflecting this, if you look within the NSS data and you look in the manufacturing sector, the one group where you see women's participation as a share increasing is is entrepreneurship. So there's clearly a big rise in the sense of, if I can get work at home, it's coming there. Alongside, one very place we do see this reflected is that we see that women in their own sector do also seem to be able to increasingly access finance. So it's worth remembering that post the microfinance crisis in around 2010, there's been a huge jump back in microfinance lending in India. And today, India has the largest number of microfinance borrowers in the world, which, you know, in absolute numbers, India often does very well. But I think it's still a large number. It's roughly, I think, 3% of its population is active population. And roughly 80% of this will be women. And again, that's one reason why I'm going to look at the microfinance interventions in a bit more detail afterwards. So against this background, what I want to argue is that when you look at the data in India, when you look a little bit more at both descriptive evidence and other forms of evidence, the one thing that seems to strike out is the presence of strong gender norms. Yesterday in the sessions I was in, I think this was a theme repeatedly a number of individuals came back to. And I think it's a large growing literature that looks at this. But the one thing that this literature has typically not tended to do is distinguish between the strength of belief in norms between men and women. So if you look at the typical paper that looks at sort of modeling culture or norms, it basically assumes there is a gender norm that is held constant at the country level. What I'm going to argue is that one thing you do seem to see in the data is men and women have different levels of attachment to the norms. In particular, men often have a much stronger sense of stigma or shame from having a working wife than the working wife herself does. And this, again, directly implies that you can start thinking in a collective household model. This is something you're going to have to bargain over. So the first question you might ask, you know, in general in the data, do we see that gender norms are more strongly held by men? So just as a first pass, what we did is we took the World Value Survey, which exists for, I think, 75 countries across the world. And they have a set of questions which define norms for men versus women when it comes to work. So it's questions like, men make better executives than women. If jobs are scarce, a man should get a priority on a job. Housework is the most fulfilling thing for a woman, and one more. So we took just the aggregate index of that, and then we looked at the difference between the gender norm among men and women. And the most striking thing to me was that out of the 76 countries we looked at, there was only a single country in which women believe these norms more strongly than men. So if you look here, this is just showing you the difference between the female to male work support index. And you can see there is only a single Middle Eastern country where this is negative. So women more strongly believe that that a woman's place is at home if there's a scarcity of jobs. India is down here. And more generally, what you see is a reasonably significant correlation between this gender gap in norms and female labor supply. So that's one thing that's going to underlie how we're going to think about this idea, is to really ask the question of, when you have these differences in norms, how do you start thinking about choices? So another way, the next question you may want to ask is, fine, you may have norms. What are the ways in which these norms translate into economic behavior? So there could just be a strong norm that women don't work, but there may be more diffuse norms that end up having the effect of not just affecting whether or not a woman works, but the kind of sector she enters into. And that in some ways is relevant when you start looking at data that tells you that women are in the labor force but are potentially not as productive. You want to ask questions about whether their choice of sector, not just whether they're able to work, is affected by these norms. So I think this is now well documented by many people in the literature. I've used data from the second round of the IHDS, but you could do it from any of the DHS surveys, is that India is striking in the number of people who need number of women who need permission to undertake activities that involve mobility. And you know, I think this is something, sitting here in Delhi, we might find hard to believe, but you know, I've certainly seen this repeatedly in the one area that I've worked quite a lot in the last few years, that you will hear women repeatedly saying that they cannot leave the house, for instance, even to buy vegetables without permission. So in the IHDS, which is a representative across India, 80% of the women need permission to go to the local health center, and typically 30% say they, in any case, cannot go there alone, even if they get permission. And we find similar constraints on most actions. And you know, this reflects clearly into participation, not just in economic activity, but also in political activity. So I think this is something that in some ways is quite unique as a gender norm to South Asia. And to put this in context, if you look in the Chinese data and you look at migration trends, the highest proportion of female migration in China occurs in the age group of 15 to 19, where women are migrating to the coasts where the jobs are. If you look in India, 97% of female migration happens at the time of marriage. So these are very different trends in terms of how mobility is affecting you at the point in time when you're thinking of entering the labor force. So let me just briefly talk about a few kind of statistics that start showing how these norms and these mobility restrictions play out in just the decision of whether to work and how to work. So I think there's some people out here also who've been involved in this. So this is just some descriptive work that we did using information on trainees of skills, one of the skills training programs in India. So, you know, one of the recent big policy moves is increase manufacturing through Make in India, and alongside engage a lot in skilling populations through Skill India. So we looked at a set of trainees in the Northern Belt. So this is the belt which has some of the lowest female labor force participation rates. Just to give you a sense, the lowest female labor force participation is in Bihar across India, which according to the NSS is 6%. So what do we see? So this is taking data on roughly 2,700 trainees who got trained in a skills training program. So they were recruited from villages and provided an 8 or 9 week training. And one of the aims of the program is that the government requires you to try to place roughly 70% of the trainees in jobs. And so what you see is that at every stage, women are less likely to get offered jobs. So 60% of the men get offered jobs, 40% of the women get offered jobs. They're much less likely to accept the jobs. And then conditional on accepting the jobs, they're also more likely to quit. So we see that at each stage, the pipe is much leakier when it comes to these kind of young rural women, which really are the place where we are seeing kind of growth in unemployment in the process. When you look at the end at those who accepted their jobs, we don't see very big differences. We don't see any difference in job satisfaction. So if you look at all of those who were in, placed, those who left, and those who remain in the job, in all cases, you don't see a gender gap. So it doesn't seem to be the case that the jobs being provided are deeply unsuited for women, or they're just like really unhappy in those jobs. So when you look at satisfaction, it looks very similar. But when you look at the reasons for why they either don't accept the job or they quit conditional on getting, you find a very stark and similar pattern in both cases, which is basically that men don't take up jobs or quit because of inadequate pay, and women don't take up jobs or quit because of family reasons. And this shows up throughout the thing, that for men, it's very clear, it's pay related. It's something that gets discussed a lot in the media, this idea that, you know, there's a big difference right now in India between the wages paid by the employer and that received by the employee. That certainly shows up for men. But when it comes to women, we see it is completely, the predominant reason is family related, family pressure, have to go back to get married. And so I think against this background, what I want to move to now is a discussion of why I think this tells us that if you want to think seriously about female labor force participation, in some sense, what we should not do is, Farzana and I were joking about this yesterday, is you see a lot of papers that interact the gender dummy in the main specification. That's a very common way, in some sense, of trying to look for gender effects. I think that's exactly what you don't want to do once you recognize that these are decisions being made in a household, in a collective household, and you actually want to model that and come up with some predictions from it. So just to remind you, if you start taking these collective models of households seriously, we think then of the household as an economic environment. And it's really, that's what it is. It's an economic environment among which people are bargaining, choosing decisions, but the individuals in that household are individuals with their own preferences. I wanted to summarize here as a background some of the things we have learned in the economics literature when we've taken this view. I think the first thing on which there are now an increasing number of papers tell us that norms seem to matter for the bargaining power that men and women have. So if you have norms that, for instance, restrict economic mobility, this affects the amount of resources a woman can have as a job, that's going to directly affect her bargaining power. We've also learned that it's important to distinguish efficiency and equity. You can have a lot of cases where a collective model household will achieve the Pareto frontier. It will manage to have an efficient outcome, but it will look very unequal. And I think that's important because it suggests that you don't want to jump on every negative gender dummy and say that's a terrible outcome. You're going to have to take a view on the trade-offs you may want to think about between efficiency and equity. I think it's important, and this is something I'm going to come back to, it also tells us something about time horizons we should be thinking about, especially in evaluations. If you induce changes in women's bargaining power through public policy, the first effect it may have is changing economic activities that will then influence their bargaining power. So, and I'll come back to this again. Right now, the kind of the status quo, I think, in the literature is we look at women's empowerment very often through these self-stated measures on decision-making within the household. That may actually change well after initial decisions like labor supply or mobility change. And the fact that we don't track those shorter-term measures very often means that we far too often potentially talk about policies as having no effect, while they may be actually having, in some sense, the first stage effects needed for final changes in decision making. And the final thing, which I think is very interesting, and we've recently started seeing some literature on this, is when women have low bargaining power within the household, it's not obvious for them the household is always the right economic environment within which to push for policy change. So if you think about the literature we've started seeing on, say, self-help groups or some of the literature on microfinance, at some level, you may think that you want to make decisions within the household because decisions like, for instance, food for children is going to happen within the household. However, if you face very low bargaining power within the household and potentially very different preferences on an outcome like, say, alcohol, you may actually choose that the right unit for you to move for change through is the network of women. And certainly when we think about the civic movements we've seen around anti-alcohol recently in Indian states, that does suggest, for instance, that's one parameter where women have decided that they are actually going to bargain a move for change outside the network. Let me now, in some sense, from the very broad set of learnings, turn to two specific examples of where I would argue that you would potentially change the conclusions you reach by looking at the results through a collective lens rather than an individual. So, as I said, sort of in India, if you look at the data, people who move out of agriculture, women who are moving out of agriculture, are largely moving into own account activities, entrepreneurship of different kinds. So I think it's reasonably relevant to be looking at what happens, for instance, in the kind of microfinance or financial inclusion literature as a way of understanding one of the reasons why women may or may not be successful in getting economic activity outside the agricultural sector. So there was an influential literature that still continues a few years ago, which is the so-called kind of cash drop or cash grant literature, that basically set up very nice experiments to look at this question, is that if I randomly provide a cash grant of $100 or $200 to an enterprise, and the seminal study was done in Sri Lanka, what do we see as the effect on enterprise development? And this was really at some basic level the question of, do capital constraints matter? And they found two sets of results. So the first was, yes, capital constraints seem to matter. When you provide these cash grants, you see returns on average of something like 8 to 9% per month, so high cash returns for small enterprises, entrepreneurs in Sri Lanka. And this finding has since been replicated in a number of countries, including Ghana. However, the second thing that they did is when they did the interaction with the gender dummy, what they found is that these effects were completely concentrated among men. So you find high returns to male entrepreneurship and relatively low returns, or actually not relatively low, zero returns to female entrepreneurship. So that's one finding that's out there in the literature. I think it's a reasonably well-replicated experimental finding. The second one is, in some sense, the kind of miracle of microfinance literature. So there was a set of very influential special issue in AEJ Applied that looked across a set of microfinance interventions, and they largely found no evidence of female empowerment when they looked at the outcome of decision making across a set of variables. And I think, you know, I certainly see this finding a lot in the policy domain, this idea that there is little evidence that microfinance affects women's empowerment. I think that's a very broadly accepted. I'm going to argue that if you take the theory of the household seriously, if you think that women are making decisions within the context of a household, then you can find certainly results that kind of question both these conclusions. So let me talk a bit about that. So the reason for I and a set of my authors to get interested in the first returns to female enterprise was actually some completely separate work that we had been doing. So we'd been working in Calcutta, and we ran a field experiment with a microfinance that only lent to women, and we varied contractual flexibility. So we varied whether you get the typical microfinance contract, so you start repaying after 1 week, or whether you get a grace period for 2 months at the start where you don't pay at all, and then you start paying. And when we did that, we found very significant changes which persisted 3 years later. So we found that on average, the clients who had gotten the more flexible contract were on average showed business profits that were 41% higher and monthly household incomes that was roughly 20% higher. And we wrote down an economic model arguing how this made sense in a world where there were high risk investment activities that you would not undertake if you had to start repaying very soon, but you could afford to undertake if you had a longer time period over which to smooth outcome. But then a couple of years ago, Erica and I were talking, and we kind of said that, you know, one thing that's striking about this is that if women had low returns, it's sort of striking that we see these effects because a lot of the cash grant literature shows no effects for female entrepreneurs. And so then we start thinking about, is there any way in which we can reconcile what we were finding with the cash grant results, or is this just another case that slightly different things are producing different results? And we realized that one big difference in how we had done our work and how the cash grant done came from how the sampling and measurement took place. So in the cash grant literature, the typical way is I sample a set of entrepreneurs. So I basically go do a census of an area, find the entrepreneurs. I give them the cash grant, or I don't give them the cash grant, so I randomize which entrepreneurs get the cash grant, and then I measure the returns to their enterprise. But the fact that seems to be in the background and missed out by this approach, and which is very similar in some sense to the agricultural household model, is that female entrepreneurs, on average, are much more likely to live with male entrepreneurs. So what we're saying is that the households in which a female entrepreneur lives is going to very often be a multiple enterprise household in which there are both male entrepreneurs and female entrepreneurs. So now, if you start taking this perspective of the household, and going back to this issue that you may be reaching efficiency even if you're not seeing returns, sorry, even if you're not seeing equitable outcomes, means that if a woman is married to or has other people in the household with enterprises, and those are higher return enterprises, then in any point in time, if I get a cash infusion, I should put it where is the highest return in the household. This is a classic separability result in economics. It's something that's been tested a lot in agricultural household models, but somehow we've forgotten about this when we came to looking at enterprises. So the first thing we did was we just looked at this in our data because we actually had for each household all the enterprises. And we see exactly the same result as the cash papers. If we run our regressions at the enterprise level, then what we basically see, this is the effect of, this is just the average profits of the control women. And you can see the increase from getting grace period is very small and is insignificant. So it's zero. On the other hand, and this was the result that we reported in our paper, which was that we were computing household level profits at the household level, and we saw this big rise. So you can see that even in our data, when you look at it at the enterprise level, we completely replicate the papers that we see in the literature on the cash grant side, but you see a very different pattern if you move to household. And then when you break it up by type of household, you see exactly this notion that it does matter what's the mix. So if you take households where a woman is the only enterprise owner, we see comparable returns just in terms of kind of the increase as we do for male profits in a household that has both a male and a female enterprise. So a mixed household is a household where both men and women have enterprises. But in mixed households, essentially, there is nothing you're seeing happening on female entrepreneurs. So essentially, they're taking the money and putting it into the highest return activity, which is male. This doesn't, in some sense, you could say, tell us something about whether what the constraints underlying are. It's largely a measurement point, but I think it's an important measurement point. We also then went back, and so in the Dimmel McKinsey paper, they don't have household profits. But given this, what we could do is we could ask the similar question by just breaking up by type of household. So we could say that if we took the Sri Lanka study and we focused in on the enterprise profits in households where there were women entrepreneurs, but they were the only entrepreneurs in the household, we recover estimates similar to the average. Similarly, if we take just female entrepreneurs and we look as the outcome household income rather than enterprise profits, we also see a significant increase of 8%. So I think what this measurement point tells us that you want to be thinking about the right model, and then you want to be thinking about where they're investing in that. It, of course, leaves a set of open questions. Why are female-owned enterprises the relatively low-return enterprises in the household? Is this a desire for flexibility? Is this an effect of these mobility constraints that I work on those enterprises that I can do from home? But I think at least it has the effect of opening a set of questions that as economists we can start thinking about harder. And I think this is the reason, one important reason why we want to move away from these gender interaction regressions where we learn a fact, but it's not a fact that necessarily is very informative of either what's happening in the household nor of where the constraints may be. The second thing I just wanted to briefly talk about was the microfinance papers. Yeah, please.
The marginal
So they don't give cash drops to both members. So in order to actually look at whether the marginal return for the male enterprise is the same as the female enterprise, you would want an experiment where you shock both members and then see how that moves. So unfortunately, that experiment hasn't been done yet, but clearly needs to be done. That's a great question. So turning to the sort of literature on kind of the miracles of microfinance, I said sort of, 80% of microfinance clients the world over are women. There is no other public or private sector program that has so successfully targeted women. And I think that's like an important thing that we shouldn't forget when we think about the impacts of microfinance. So as I said, there's a very influential and fantastic set of field experiments on AEG applied. And they focus on decision-making power within the